Ashley Klein from Plainfield. Your national anthem, please.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the brave?
Thank you, Asha. If everyone would join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please be seated. Welcome, everyone. Thank you for taking time out of your busy schedules to be with us today, help celebrate the rollout of our newly restored A4C Skyhawk. My name is Larry Greenwich, and I'm the current president of the Illinois Aviation Museum's Board of Directors. I'd like to thank the Civil Air Patrol cadets from the Shorty Powers Composite Squadron, the Navy Sea cadets from the Ghost Rider Squadron, VFW Post 5917, and the American Legion Post 1288 for the presentation of colors. We have a few people I'd like to acknowledge from the Museum Board of Directors. Bill Anderson is here, but he's not in the room. Joe DiPaolo is here, back corner. Jim Gold, who is our head of restorations here. Eric Hayes is our treasurer. Jan Lindsay, board member. Ed Meyer, Arzania Williams, my vice president, and Arnie Zimmerman is here. With from the village, we have Mayor Claire, Deputy Mayor Leroy Brown, Trustee Rick Morales, and Maurice Zarate. I'd also like to thank, give everyone applause. They serve our community well. There's some other people I'd really like to introduce to you, not to make a big deal, but Noah Lineman was here. He's here with his family today. Noah's going to be an Eagle Scout tomorrow, and his community project that he did was for us. It's this beautiful viewing stand that we will have on display with our A4, so we appreciate all his hard work and all the crew that he had. From Axo Nobel, who very generously donated paint for not only our A4, but also for the T2, the orange jet out there. Trish is here from Maxo Nobel. Thank you, Trish. Is Phil Slack here? I did not see Phil. No. Phil Slack was from P&G Crane Services, who came out on multiple occasions to help us put this plane back together, as well as take it apart. And he also fabricated some brackets that allowed us to store the wing and move it around, things like that. Without him, we would certainly not have been able to do what we did. But Phil, I definitely wanted to give him a mention. Walt Brand is here. He's from Attack Squadron VA-93. He's here with his wife. Walt, where are you at? Walt actually flew the airplane that we restored and will be presenting to you. Also from VA-93, Robert Weidman is here, along with his cousins Gail and Diane. Mr. Weidman will be speaking a little bit later. There he is. Paul Wood from the Warbird Heritage Foundation in Waukegan could not be here, but I have to tell you, none of this would be happening without Paul, because he donated the plane to our museum. So Paul deserves a big round of applause. Okay, so a lot of you know who we are, but a lot of people really don't know too much about our museum. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about it. We host educational tours for youth, seniors, special needs, and pretty much anyone else that wants to come around, make an appointment, and we give them educational tours. Thank you, Julie. You want to come on to that? The museum also hosts monthly safety seminars for existing and pilot wannabes. We hold ground school to help the youth become future aviators. EAA Chapter 461, we host their Young Eagle flights here, and a Young Eagle flight offers free flights to children from 7 to 17, introduce them to general aviation. The museum also participates heavily in the airport's cavalcade of planes, which is if you've never been here, it's a huge event. We have all sorts of planes on display. We're also in local parades and a lot of other community events, 4th of July, things like that. We're also currently in the middle of our Build a Plane project, where we're actually engaging the community to come out and help learn about and to actually help build a flyable aircraft. And the plane we're doing is the Zenith CH-750 Cruiser. It's actually, if you turn around, it's back there. That's where they're building it. It's an all-aluminum plane. And at the end of the program, I invite everyone to go back there, pull a rivet, sign a logbook, and you'll all have a hand in building our airplane. Thanks to the EAA on the national level, they, along with the local chapter, got a set of wings which are on display in the back that were built at the EAA convention up in Oshkosh this summer, as well as a $500 donation for materials to help complete our project. So the EAA really was a big part of this. I appreciate that. A round of applause for them. Again, when the program's over, everyone's invited to go back there. It'll take you 2 minutes to pull a rivet, sign a logbook, and everyone's got a hand in history. I'm going to talk a little bit about the TAC Squadron VA-93. It was part of the Air Wing 5. They were nicknamed the Blue Blazers from 1954 through 1976. And where it gets interesting is back in 1965, when Bolingbroke was just being incorporated, our Skyhawk was assigned to the USS Enterprise. Also on board the Enterprise was a young man serving his country below deck. That young man finished his tour, moved to Bolingbroke, and currently sits on our board of directors of this museum. His name is Bill Anderson, and you'll meet him in just a minute. The executive officer back in 65 was William Gene Sizemore, an Illinois native from Chauncey, Illinois, who retired after 1,036 carrier landings as a rear admiral. Due to commitments in Washington, he's unable to join us today. But I have to tell you about a huge, huge, extraordinary coincidence. Admiral Sizemore's son, who's also a retired rear admiral, arranged to have his father at a rollout last week of an A4 that sat on the Enterprise in 1965 and VA-93, and that was just rolled out last week in Indiana. So He couldn't be here, but he was there, and it's just a huge, huge coincidence that two aircraft from the same fighter group are restoring the same colors within a week of each other. That's kind of unusual. The Douglas A4 Skyhawk was affectionately called the Scooter by those who flew it. It is a single-engine, delta-wing light attack jet with a top speed of over 600 miles an hour. The A4 was developed in the 50s and had its first flight on June 22, 1954. It was used by the U.S. Navy Blue Angels demonstration team immediately preceding their current F-A-18. It was used by the U.S. Marines as well as the U.S. Navy, most notably in Vietnam and in the Falklands, where there was a total of 2,960 A4s built. The A4 was retired from Marine use in 1998 and from the Navy in 2003, but they are currently still being used by many other countries. At this time, I'd like to present our A4 Charlie model, Bureau number 148500, being brought about by the young man from the USS Enterprise, Mr. Billy Anderson. How about that? That's a beautiful aircraft. At this time, I'd like to bring up Joe DiPaolo, the airport manager, who'd like to say a few words about the airport.
Thanks, Larry. Just a few quick words. The first, congratulations. What a beautiful restoration that you see here behind me. We here at the airport are so proud to have the Illinois Aviation Museum located here at Bolingbrook's Cloud International Airport. The museum, this project, and other projects that they're involved with are another example of the culture of the community involvement we have here. For an airport, this culture is very unique. Evidence of that is this year, the Spirit of Flight Award was issued by the state of Illinois, of which I was privileged to also attend with many of those from the museum. This museum, based on that, shows that there is a statewide recognition of the Illinois Aviation Museum. You know, this airport and this museum is kind of a microcosm of the village itself. It promotes community involvement. By evidence of everybody here, all the involvement and the help that we had with the plane itself. And it's an atmosphere here of good is not good enough. And this restoration is a fine example of that. The museum and the airport in general not just supports the community, but they are also supporters of us. This starts with the village of officials. Thank you for your continued support, many of which are here today, which shows you that community involvement. With that, I'd like to introduce to you the mayor of Bolingbrook, Roger C. Clare.
Thank you, Joe. This is a great event today. The project speaks for itself. Bolingbrook's very proud to have this airport, museum, our annual air show, and so forth. I need to give you just a bit of brief history. Some of you may not know the history of this airport. Boyd Cloud built it back in, I believe, the mid-50s or the 50s. And frankly, when I became mayor 29 years ago, I knew at some point this airport was going to end up in my lap. 1998, well, first of all, Boyd sold off pieces for Lowe's and for Home Depot and for Meyer, and just kept whittling away at the property he had acquired, because it really wasn't necessary to the operation of the airport. And he finally got down to a piece, which the bulk of the airport, I said, Boyd, the next sale, the airport comes into Bolingbrook, or we're going to block the sale, because we wanted it in Bolingbrook. It still had a Plainfield, Illinois postal address until the 90s. Anyway, Boyd then put it up for sale, which I knew was eventually going to happen, and Joe DiPaolo stepped up to buy it, and we thought, that's fine. Boyd or Joseph DiPaolo, he'll run this thing well. I think it was like a lifelong fantasy to own his own airport. Is that fair, Joe?
A fantasy.
So after about 6 years, the thrill was gone, and he decided to put it up for sale. And consequently, it went on the market. I think it was Jim Hughes Construction was going to buy it. They built the homes over behind the theater across the street. And Jim Hughes was going to buy it, I believe, for $13.5 million. And I went, wow. I didn't really want to do what Jim Hughes did, and that was bulldoze the airport, put some more retail in the corner, put some multifamily housing next to that, and then the main airport would be single-family housing, a very traditional building plan. So I met with Joe, and I said, Joe, I don't really want that to happen. This is something I want to preserve. Didn't necessarily know what for. I just didn't want to let it get away. So Joe, in the compassionate, giving man that he asked, said, well, for $13.5 million, you can have it. The timing wasn't real good. We just got through a number of major capital projects, but we came up with the money, and we've not looked back since. So we bought it in approximately 2004, and again, it continues to improve. Interestingly enough, when we bought it, Illinois Department of Transportation Division of Aviation was thrilled. The FAA was very happy because this is a very important airport for the state of Illinois. In fact, the president of IOPA, it's the National Airport for
Airport Operations.
He flew in here in a jet, landed just to come in and have coffee with me and thank me in the village for buying the airport. Anyway, basically, we decided we wanted to turn it into what I would consider an airfield into an airport. So we started making improvements. We submitted to the federal government, FAA, what's called an ALP, Airport Layout Plan. That's common lingo with the Federal Aviation Administration. And that was, we showed the airport and what we wanted to do and what they wanted us to do, because when you get in bed with the federal government, you get in bed with some of their rules. So they had a number of things they wanted us to do. Some we agreed with, some we don't, and we're still fighting with them yet today. One, they wouldn't put a fence around the airport, Homeland Security. I just didn't think that'd look good. And quite frankly, if a terrorist could stop by a 6-foot fence, you know, think about it. Anyway, we are going to be putting in lights. And of course, there's $6.3 million sitting out there in a new runway. And that was one of the things we wanted, was federal state money. The feds are paying 90% of that. I believe they'll come through with it because they can just keep spending even though they're massive in debt. The state of Illinois, they're massive in debt, but I'm not sure they'll be able to give us money we want it, but we will eventually get it. And the village shares approximately $350,000 to build that runway. And again, that's one of the reasons. We're still fighting over the trees on the west side. They want to cut all those trees down. We don't want them to cut the trees down. And you can't imagine how much time has been spent on about 50 trees, including congressional offices, the FAA, and meetings with the State Department of Aviation. In fact, yesterday, I called the State Department of Aviation and told them the current status, and I won't quote what the guy said because he was quite unhappy to hear. They still wanted to cut more trees down than they wanted. But you'll be able to tell as you drive by, if there's trees gone, we lost. They're still up, we won. Again, this airport's approximately 75 acres. And personally, as Mayor Bolingbrook and the village board and I concurred, that it's keep 75 acres for this purpose available just seemed like the smart thing to do. It could always be sold later, but I didn't want it to be gone going to be saying today, boy, I wish we'd have kept that airport. We kept the name Clow, as respect for Boyd Clow, whose picture's on that back wall. And of course, Boyd called it International Airport, and we like that too. Even I'm not sure the story on how that really happened, but there's several of them floating around, and you could choose the one you like the most. This is community involvement. That's what it's done with the air show, the young Eagles, and Liam the Eagle Scout building this. It provides lots of opportunities for lots of people, and of course, it's a great airport. I just want to say one last thing, kind of on a negative. Any of you read a year or two ago an article about the Rocket Ice Arena in Bolingbrook? Front page Tribune article. Well, that same reporter is going to do the same thing on the airport. He has pulled what are called FOIAs, Freedom of Information Act requests, over 38 of them in the last 3 years, which required duplication of thousands of pages and provision of many, many DVDs, and it's all about trying to find out the boogeyman, for lack of a better word, that he's convinced there's something that's not good here. They initially thought it was because I wanted an airport so I had a place to play. Well, I don't fly planes, so that knocked that out of the box. But it should be coming out soon. I'm sorry it's coming out because it's going to distort what's been a beautiful thing and a beautiful addition to the corporate boundaries of the Village of Bolingbrook. And with that, I will close by saying, Cardinal fans, get over it. White Sox fans, come on. You really want the Cubs to win, don't you? Go Cubs. We also had join us during the remarks, Gene Kelly, Deputy Assessor of DeBase Township, and Bill Mayer, Township Supervisor, and a former trustee who was one of the people who voted to purchase this airport, Sandy Swincunas.
Thank you, Mayor. Apparently I got a bigger mouth. At this point, I'd like to bring up Pastor Nelson from Joyful Spirit Church. That's right across our street, and here he is.
Mayor, I have to say to you that my dad always said to me, dogs don't bark at standing trains. So I thank you for your vision, and I thank you for thinking big. Let us pray. God, we thank you so much for all those who have prepared and had vision and done wonderful things so we can enjoy them. Thank you so much for them. Thank you for the person who donated this plane. Thank you for the people who run this museum, who run our village here. Thank you for all who volunteer behind the scenes to make all this possible. Lord, we praise you today, and please bless this airplane and all who will see it. Lord, we thank you again. Thank you for this beautiful day you have given us. In your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Pastor. At this time, I'd like to introduce Mr. Robert Wideman. Mr. Wideman is a proud father of two sons and has six grandchildren. He flew 134 missions in Vietnam and was a POW there for 6 years. He is a lawyer and has practiced law in Florida and Mississippi. In 1965, Mr. Wideman served in Air Wing 5, Attack Squadron VA-93, the same squadron that our aircraft was attached to aboard the USS Enterprise. So please give Mr. Robert Wideman a warm welcome.
And also, this won't take long. I do want to acknowledge my cousins, Gail and Diane, and their husbands for being here again. My squadron mate and friend, Walter Brand, and his wife, Brenda, the mayor, and other dignitaries. A few years ago, I'm having lunch with the bar organization in Meridian, Mississippi, and a couple of my lawyer friends, Leonard Codds on the left, Bob Bresnahan sitting in front of me, and for some reason, Bob Bresnahan and I, we were talking about my time in the slammer. And Leonard looks at me and says, "You were a POW?" And I say, "Yes." He says, "How many years?" I said, "6 years. Why do you think I'm so gooned up?" He says, "Oh, I thought that was because you went to law school." I checked the board with Tommy Wonder Jim. We lost him last year, may he rest in peace, in January 1966 aboard the Enterprise, and they were flying off Yankee Station against North Vietnam. Well, I'm the junior ensign, and Commander Sizemore, now Admiral, was a squadron skipper. And as a junior ensign, Commander Sizemore says, "Well, you know, he's going to be my wingman. You know, the most experienced, the least experienced, I guess he thought I was teachable." So I'm on his wing for about 3 months, 2 or 3 months, walk in the radio room one morning, and the commander says, "Weidman, you're leading this flight, so brief it." Well, so I briefed. It was a standard two-ship. We take off, and we meet up with the forward air controller. We drop our bombs, come back to the ship, and land. So I briefed the flight, and when I finished the briefing, he only briefed one thing. He says, "Weidman," he says, "when we come back, there's going to be a holding pattern, and there's going to be airplanes stacked every 1,000 feet. You know, and we're going to have our assigned holding altitude, but," he says, "I want you to descend to your holding altitude before you get into the holding pattern. I do not want you descending through that holding pattern with all those airplanes." He says, "You know, yes sir, no sir, three bags, full sir." We go out, we fly the mission, uneventful. We come back, I do my calculation, start my descent, and I realize, "You know, Weidman, you're going to be coming down right through the middle of that holding pattern. And Commander Sizemore is just going to have a piece of mind, you know what, you know." I said, "Oh, man." Anyway, so, you know, we get in holding, we survive holding, we shoot the approach of the ship, we both land uneventful. And I'm walking down to the ready room, and I'm thinking, "Man, he is really going to get me." So walk into the ready room. I debriefed the flight. He did not say a word. He knew that I felt so bad about screwing up, you know, that was, he didn't have to say anything. And that's the kind of person he was. He was a great skipper. He was a great leader. He was also a very good pilot, which is unusual for the older squadron commanders. Thank you for inviting me. Thanks for listening. It's been an honor to visit with you.
Thanks very much. Just wanted to mention that Senator Jennifer Bertino Tarrant has joined us today, taking time out of her busy schedule. Thank you very much, Senator. At this time, we're just about done. Does anyone have any questions? None? Good, because I don't know the answers. Again, I'd like to invite everyone to, when we're done, to go ahead and go to the back, pull a rivet, sign a logbook. Be a great thing for us. And Bill Anderson is, there he is. I'm going to bring Bill up, and he'd like to make a few statements.
Thanks, Mark. Okay, I'm going to make this real brief. On our glass showcases over there, I have got my cruise book, which is equivalent to a high school yearbook from 1965. Please thumb through it. I've got some tabs of this squadron, VA-93. There's another orange tab of when Gene Sizemore became the commanding officer of the squadron. I believe it was in January of 65. We did the official change of command from one commander to the other commander of the squadron. So please take a look at the logbooks. Above the logbook, when I was on the carrier, I collected squadron patches. I was not an aviation person. I was ship's company. I kept the supplies moving so the flyers could fly and the ship could do what it needed to do. But I collected patches, and I've got one of the originals there. So other than that, Larry, thank you.
Okay, that concludes our program. Thank you very much for taking time out of your days.
What do you mean?